once a luxury, now an economy product. Shrimps. Tasty, low-fat, and cheap. But in Thailand, a massive shrimp industry has destroyed large parts of the country's mangrove forests. Conservationists are sounding alarms. Extensive use of chemicals and untreated wastewater pollute large areas. Thousands of Burmese work for a pittance in the Thai shrimp factories. They live in appalling conditions. What are the real impacts of large-scale shrimp production? Iris Mann, a fish expert with the environmental organization Greenpeace, starts her research into the world's favorite seafood at Hamburg's wholesale fish market. We join her.
Shrimps, scampi, king prawns, they're on the menu of every Italian restaurant and in the freezer of every supermarket. They're now a mass product, available everywhere. Most of the shrimp on the German market come from Thailand. And no one knows anything about how they're produced.
The prices of these small crustaceans have halved over the past 10 years. The Germans eat 56,000 tons of shrimp a year.
A massive freezer filled entirely with shrimp, most of them from shrimp farms. Big kilo bags. If you look at what's in this shop alone at this massive shrimp, you can imagine how many shrimp farms are needed to supply the world market.
Greenpeace estimates that there are around 300,000 shrimp farms worldwide. At the environmental organization's headquarters in Hamburg, Iris Mann and her colleague Thilo Mack plan to get an overview of the whole shrimp business. By simply typing in shrimp aquaculture Thailand, Thilo Mack finds reports on what he calls the whole cabinet of horrors. Mangrove destruction, introduction of non-native species, use of antibiotics, chemicals, disinfectants, and social issues as well. The fish experts also find that production is almost exclusively concentrated in South America and, above all, Southeast Asia. Iris Mann's research shows that most of the shrimp sold in Germany come from Thailand. 4 to 4,500 tons a year. Mostly from the Gulf of Thailand, but also from the other side of the Malay Peninsula. But the information revealed by this initial surge is 5 to 8 years old. The researchers realize they'll actually have to visit production sites to find out about the situation today. Are the conditions in the shrimp industry still as bad as they were? Iris Mann intends to find out and heads off to the biggest shrimp producer in the world, Thailand. We go with her. A foretaste from the air. The satellite picture shows the entire east coast is fringed with shrimp ponds. From Bangkok, we drive to the heart of the shrimp industry, Chantaburi province in the southeast of the country. 20 years ago, there was nothing here but a few mines. But thanks to shrimp farming, the area has become prosperous. Some families now live in villas. The price has been paid by nature. Outside the town, aquaculture operations as far as the eye can see. The German marine biologist is helped by a member of the Greenpeace Thailand team. She has received a tip that this farm is preparing for harvest. Electric paddle wheels aerate and oxygenize the massive shrimp ponds, an indication perhaps of over-intensive farming. This has nothing to do with traditional fishing. It's a task performed by heavy machinery. Giant pumps empty the ponds, sucking the shrimp out with the water.
What we see here is the unfiltered water from the ponds being pumped straight into the delta and the open sea, which means that all the pesticides, all the nutrients in the water go with it. And that is deplorable, of course.
An environmental disaster. The contaminated water flows directly into one of the world's most sensitive ecosystems, mangroves. We're told that this small grow-out pond alone contains 300,000 shrimp. To the marine biologist, that's an unacceptable density. The crustaceans spend 3 months vegetating on the floor of the pond, crawling over one another in their own feces.
This is the last of the harvest coming out of the pond. You can clearly see all the sludge, muck, and excrement they have to wash off before the shrimp can be sorted.
The shrimp are killed in icy cold water and then sorted. Greenpeace demands that packaging should show where shrimp come from. They should be traceable to an actual farm. But as one wholesaler here told us, the present system permits nothing like that.
The shrimp are not identified. Harvests from different farms go to a factory and everything gets mixed up.
Back in Germany, we tried to find out where Thai shrimp comes from, but none of the major discount chains were willing or able to tell us. Here we're told that most international customers buy their shrimp where the price is lowest. But at that stage, the harvests have already been mixed. Iris Mann wants to know more about what is being pumped into the mangroves.
I've taken samples from the outlet for analysis, random samples of the water that's being poured directly into the sea.
The drained pond is like an open sewer.
What we can see on the floor of the pond is that there's no oxygen here anymore. It smells of hydrogen sulfide and it's devoid of life.
The expert secretly takes another sample. She knows she mustn't be caught doing it. Iris Mann and her colleague from Greenpeace Thailand want to see where the wastewater goes and what has happened to the mangrove forests that once lined this entire coast. Kamenu Bay used to be covered in mangroves, dense tidal forest that provides shelter and protection for land, animals and people. More than 80% of the mangroves in this area have been cleared.
You can clearly see the signs of clearance here. All that's left is a thin ribbon of shrubs. The shrimp farms start right behind it, pond after pond after pond. Here we can actually see the big ponds, which are covered to make sure that birds can't get at the shrimp.
The mangroves took thousands of years to grow. Clearing them is now prohibited, but the ban is largely ignored.
I expected it to be bad, but not this bad. This is a disaster, a sorry disaster.
Small shrimp farmers also have to clear mangroves in order to survive. Ying from Greenpeace Thailand takes us to a farmer who's in a desperate plight.
We've come to a farm where there has evidently been an outbreak of disease. All the shrimp have had to be harvested and discarded as waste. We want to take a look.
Iris Mann also takes a sample of the water here. The farmer used large quantities of chemicals to save his stock, he says, but it didn't work.
Yeah, he said, of course. Yeah.
I asked the farmer how much stock he has, how many shrimp per square meter, and from his answers it seems the density is 7 times higher than is recommended for an ecological farm, hence the vigorous and rapid spread of the disease. He could lose everything here.
If a farmer's entire stock gets sick, precious little can be saved. Behind the house, Ira's man finds evidence of the farmer's desperate fight against the epidemic.
These are two pesticides that will kill everything except shrimp. Small fish larvae, for example. This is pretty awful. Shrimps swimming in water where pesticides are used. Shrimps that later end up on someone's plate.
The shrimp in this small pond are so far still healthy, and the farmer doesn't want to lose them, so he's using large amounts of chemicals to protect them. But where do the chemicals come from? Ira's man has come to look around an aquaculture supply shop.
This is an agricultural supplier that sells feed for aquaculture operations. We want to see what else they sell.
They don't like what they find. Fungicides, herbicides, and disinfectants of every description.
This is a pesticide used to kill everything in a pond except shrimp. And they seem to sell a lot of it, judging by the quantity of the stuff they keep in stock.
Is there an alternative? We visit an organic farm run by the company CP, Thailand's largest shrimp producer. CP is a big name in the shrimp business. It has its own farms, its own processing plants, and its own feed production operations.
We've come here because this is an organic farm, and we want to see what organic actually means here.
So, and what is this?
Antibiotics for the small shrimp.
Antibacterial?
Antibacterials,
okay.
There are chemicals everywhere. So much for organic.
We've just been told that this product, Virkon A, is no longer used. But if you look at this expiry date and the date of manufacture, you see that it was made in 2011 and should be used by 2014. And this is a new box, so it presumably is still used.
We're told that the giant shrimp producer also supplies the German market, but no one here wants to disclose the identity of its customers.
On the aerators, the paddle wheels, and here at the edge of the pond, there's green algae growing. That's a sign of nutrient-rich water. The algae multiply, and chemicals like Virkon A are used to control them. This is anything but organic. There are said to be nearly a million shrimp in this pond, 800,000 crustaceans.
The marine biologist has seen enough. This is not her idea of an organic farm. Bangkok. Ira's man takes her samples to a lab. She didn't take shrimp samples because she knows that farmers stop applying pharmaceuticals and most chemicals before the harvest so that they're not present in the shrimp when it's sold. Change of scene, Hamburg. A few days later, the first lab results arrive at Greenpeace headquarters. Marine biologist Thilo Mark is curious to see how contaminated the Thai shrimp ponds are.
For one thing, we have a very high level of chlorine, which is no doubt due to the use of disinfectant. But what's also very high is the level of copper at 90 milligrams a kilo. 100 milligrams is the threshold for hazardous waste, according to German law. So 90 milligrams is not much short of the mark.
Thilo Ma continues his research. He wants to know whether the Thai shrimp giant CP also operates in Germany. He finds what he's looking for.
CP has a really impressive website. The company does big business worldwide. It's evidently a global player, and it has a representative office in Hamburg. We should have a look at that.
We joined the marine biologist on the search for the Hamburg office of the Thai company CP. The first address on the website is a dud. How do the shrimp enter the German market? The food industry treats its chain of supply like a state secret. But we do find CP's low-key premises on the outskirts of the city. The Thai company invites us in, but the camera has to stay outside.
CP is evidently present in the German market. It's a regular supplier of major seafood firms like Costa and Frosta, but it also supplies McDonald's. The chain's Asia Weeks turn over a huge volume of shrimp.
Asia Weeks at McDonald's. The batter coating really does contain shrimp from Asia. Courtesy of Thai company CP, which Greenpeace now has in its sights. Back in Thailand, Ira's man is now looking into another problem. Outside a CP farm, she meets Tan Wat Chang, the mayor of a small village. He wants to tell her how much his community suffers as a result of the intensive farming in the river delta. Right alongside the CP aquaculture operation is the canal that supplies the village with water.
So he says that there's a pipe under the road here, and it goes under, it comes to this resting pond, which this resting pond is connected to the community river.
It's horrifying how much damage the shrimp farms do to the environment. The big farms pump their water straight into the local community's drinking water supply. So local people have problems getting water to meet their daily needs and to fill their own ponds. Consumers buying shrimp in Germany need to realize that they have a responsibility towards local communities like this.
Many villagers have moved away for fear of getting sick, Chang says. But it's not only people that are affected. Life underwater also suffers. Fish stocks, for example, have diminished. The mayor takes us to a traditional shrimp farm that's run on ecological principles, as in the past. Even it has been hit by the pollution caused by CP. The farmer is at his wit's end.
That is a black tiger shrimp, a species that occurs here naturally.
But now also rare, the harvest barely provides a living.
So he said that after CP has arrived, they catch less shrimp by half, and the size of the shrimp is smaller. This one is 5 months, and usually if the healthy one by 5 months, should be that big.
The farmer, Som Chai Narong, tells us how life has changed since the arrival of intensive shrimp farming for export.
When they heard that CP is coming in, they all get excited that the civilization is coming. But then, so a year after CP has arrived, they started to find that there's less shrimp in the pond. The color of the water has changed.
And how does it
change? It becomes reddish. the community has complained to CP mm-hmm. that if your water is clean, take it and recycle it, but they haven't done that, so they know it's yeah. chemical free.
Yeah, this is shocking.
It's shocking that a big company should come along fueling hopes that it will bring jobs, money, and development to this rural area, and then doing the opposite. There's a massive downside to this for the local community.
But the children still play in the river. It's the only place they have to go swimming. No one knows if there'll be negative consequences in the future from this exposure to the wastewater from the shrimp farms. One factory rubs shoulders with another. We continue to follow the shrimp's route to Europe. How are the shrimp processed for the German market? We accompany Ira's man on a visit to the Chanburi Seafood Company. Her research showed that shrimp are frozen and packed here for German supermarket chains. Despite repeated requests, we are not allowed to film. What is behind the heavy iron bars of the shrimp industry? What are we not supposed to see? We drive towards Bangkok, hoping we'll be able to film at another processing plant. Ira's man's Thai colleague Ying has received a tip that filming may be possible at the Chuksamut Seafood Company. And indeed, we are allowed in. The brochures display a German certification mark.
We're one step further. We're inside the factory gates and now at reception.
But then things get difficult. The boss calls. He has reservations. After an hour of persuasion, they offer us a compromise.
Even this company won't let us enter the production areas. We're only allowed a brief glimpse of the individual production stages on the monitor, which is a bit strange, really. Why can't we go into the factory and watch the operations there? Mm-hmm.
On the monitor, we see masked workers peeling, boiling, freezing, and packing shrimp. Shrimp processing has grown into a 5 billion euro industry worldwide.
So basically he said that he put in this type of chemical to stabilize the taste of shrimp.
Sie verwenden hier Phosphat
Ira's man identifies it as phosphate. The use of phosphate is not prohibited, but it needs to be declared. And it's certainly problematical. Phosphate causes the shrimp to retain water, which makes them heavier and thus more expensive for the customer. But is that the reason we are not allowed to film? Or is it the working conditions? We meet an informant. He works for a Thai aid organization that helps illegal immigrants. The man seems to know what the shrimp factories want to hide. He takes us to a dilapidated building where workers employed by various companies live in deplorable conditions.
We're now with workers from Burma and want to talk to them about working conditions in the shrimp industry.
Around 70 Burmese who fled from dictatorship live here in tiny partitioned rooms, distributed over the four floors of the building. They only come here to sleep because they spend almost all their waking hours working. Thao and her husband are in their early 20s and came to Thailand 4 years ago. At first, they lived here illegally. Now they at least have a work permit. Without people like them, shrimps could not be produced for such a low price. The two are in no doubt about that.
There are like 1,000 workers, mm-hmm. and wow. there's only four Thais, mm-hmm. four or five, and mm-hmm. they are the boss.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so the Thais are working in the administration, and the rest are Burmese people.
So he's daily life, he says, work starts at 6 and he will come home by 10. Mm-hmm. So,
this is 16 hours. Yeah. Overall. And how much did he earn for these 16 hours?
He gets 215 baht a day. Mm-hmm. Look, and the OT is 40 hour baht.
Food is extremely cheap in Germany. Germans are not prepared to pay a lot for food. Thankfully, that's not true of every country in Europe. Food needs to be more expensive in Germany, shrimp as well. They're far too cheap in German shops.
The house where the Burmese live has no running water, which does not bother those responsible in the shrimp industry. They profit from the poverty of their hired labor. On the ground floor, we meet two Burmese workers who are in particularly dire straits.
His work depends on shrimp. Mm-hmm. If there are shrimp, he gets to work. Mm-hmm. Normal work hour would be from 7 o'clock, to 8 o'clock at night.
Mm-hmm.
And they pay by kilo.
We learned that the two men even live at the factory so that they are always available.
So the factory looks like this, one building, mm-hmm. which the first floor is all open, that's mm-hmm. where they work. And then the second floor is where they chop up into rooms and rent out to the workers to live.
The stories get worse and worse. These two workers have just told us that other Burmese live in the factory because they can't afford to pay for their work permit. The factory owner obtains it for them and they pay off the debt gradually out of their wages. He charges them twice what the permit actually costs. So they work long hours, live on site, and if the employer says they have to get up at 3 in the morning to peel shrimp, they have to do so, or else they lose their work permit.
The Burmese have escaped from dictatorship in their own country, but now they work like slaves to produce cheap shrimps for European and American consumers. We drive again to the coastal area that was almost totally covered in mangroves 20 years ago. The clearance evidently continues.
These are new ponds they've created, new grow-out ponds for the shrimp. Three big new grow-out ponds. So shrimp farming continues to expand, to cater for the high demand for shrimp.
For more than 10 years, it has actually been prohibited in Thailand to establish new shrimp farms. But no one seems to pay any attention to that. The consequences are catastrophic, and not only for nature. With the disappearance of the mangrove forests, coastal communities have lost their natural protection from floods and tsunamis.
Here, right beside the new ponds, we see felled and uprooted mangroves. This sort of thing shouldn't happen. The green leaves show that they haven't been there long. This is actually forbidden.
Mangroves are strictly protected. The men making the new ponds here know that, but they don't accept that they've harmed the environment.
The mangrove, you have to walk further down to the river.
Cleared mangrove forests, contaminated soil and rivers, exploited wage slaves, a high price to pay for cheap shrimp.